Buddy.
Welcome to another episode of Basement Electronics. Today I want to talk about the ESP32. Now, before I get into talking about the module, I want to go into a little bit of history lesson first. So back in August 2014, a company named Espressif came out with the ESP01. And it was a pretty simple board. It had like next to no documentation, but it was small, it was very versatile, and it was easy to program. So a hacker community called AI Thinker got a hold of the board and started doing a lot of different things with it, and it soon became the ESP8266, and it very quickly gained a lot of popularity and got used in a lot of projects and even in a lot of commercial applications. So 2 years later, Espressif decided to introduce the next version of the ESP board, the ESP32. Now, the idea of this board was it was going to be kind of the next price tier, so maybe a little more expensive than the ESP8266. But then it's also good, but it also has improved processor. It has Bluetooth on it, more memory, as well as a number of attached sensor applications to it. And since it was going to be a higher price point, they decided to keep the ESP8266 around. In fact, it's still around. So this next bit's kind of anecdotal, or at least it's based on what I found. The ESP8266, as I said, is very simple, and you can see that just by the number of options you have for it. You can plug it into the Arduino IDE. You can use LUA with it, which after my initial ESP videos, I found out LUA is a separate programming language. It's not dedicated to ESP. And even has MicroPython available to it. And all those utilities make it really easy to work with ESP8266. Well, when it came time for me to investigate the ESP32, I decided to start with my favorite MicroPython and found a little bit of a shortcoming. At least as of November 2017, the Bluetooth functionality in MicroPython is still very unstable. In the main forums, there's a lot of talk about it just straight out not working because of the stack memory size in the ESP32. But that said, I have found a couple projects that use the Bluetooth. But I still don't feel very confident in using it. So I went to the next thing, which was the firmware, like the LUA firmwares. And this one made me feel even less comfortable. It doesn't have like the file system and the LUA functionality that the ESP 8266 had. Rather, it's a set of build tools where you program C language for it. And while that's a really good way to get around the stack size limitations for the Bluetooth, it certainly doesn't speak to simplicity. And while I certainly want to try, that at some point, still not today. You know, it's not something I really feel comfortable doing today. Which brings me down to the Arduino IDE. And so the IDE is certainly a great way to program the boards. Again, it's simple, it's common, it's C-based, so even though I have, even though I feel unsteady using the build tools, at least the Arduino ID is a familiar environment, and it uses a syntax that I've used many times before. So in today's demonstration, we're We're going to use the board libraries for the ESP32, and we're going to try to get the Bluetooth module working using my cell phone and the Arduino IDE.
So the first thing we need to do is we need to copy the hardware drivers for the ESP32 for the Arduino IDE. And we need to get that from GitHub. So I'm just going to use Tortoise Git. Do a clone. And there's the URL. This is all inspired by a tutorial page on randomnerdtutorials.com. I'll put the link to this one down below on how to set up the ESP32 in the Arduino IDE. So I'm going to. So here's the GIP URL, and this is where we're going to put it. So hit OK. And this is going to take a while, so I'll just be back in. I'll just be back in a couple minutes. All right, so it's done downloading. So the first thing I'm going to want to do is rename this. So the reason why I'm putting into a separate directory, and I'll explain that in just a minute. Next thing we want to do is we want to go to our Arduino hardware library. I've created a directory called Espressif off of Arduino hardware off the program files. And we're going to copy this ESP32 into this directory. And this is why I wanted to put it into a subdirectory off of my documents. It's because this is a protected directory. And if I tried doing a git directly into this directory, it would have given me a permission problems. The option would have been I would have had to start git as administrator, but that's a little annoying. So we're doing it this way instead. And this will just take a few seconds. Now it's done. So now I'm just going to start the command prompt. Don't need this one anymore. Let's keep this open as reference. Program files, Arduino. Hardware, Espressif, ESP32. Now, this is the directory that we're looking for, tools. So we're gonna see tools, and I'm just gonna run the get.exe. So, and that's going to download all the latest binaries and drivers for the ESP32. Now, this is going to take a few minutes, so I'm just going to jump ahead again. I ended up having to redo it because I needed to run the command prompt as administrator. But it grabbed all the binaries and the tools. So now, if we're to start the Arduino IDE and go to boards, we will see the ESP32 options down here. So what have we got here? Now down here we have our So this is my ESP32 module. So now, what we got here? Flash mode, QIO, that's fine. Let's stick with the 80 megahertz for now. If we have problems, we'll bring it down to 40. 4 meg, it is a 4 meg. Default partition scheme. Yeah, we'll leave that. And port is COM7. But let's take a look at the examples. So here's our Bluetooth examples. So BLE means Bluetooth low energy. But before we do that, let's just do a quick... So this time, include our Wi-Fi.h. Serial monitoring, Wi-Fi station, which is interesting because that's used in the MicroPython for the ESP8266. And then in the loop, we scan networks. If nothing, say we can't find anything. Otherwise, we run a for loop through each of the networks and we print out the information. So let's upload this and see if this works. Now there is a chance that this won't work because I might have to push the flash button on the board before it'll let me program it. Oh no, it's working. Or is it? Oh, here we go. So now, put on the proper baud rate would help. Scan start. Look at that. And it works. So that's the Wi-Fi, but well, no, the ESP8266 had Wi-Fi. We can do better than that. Let's give our Bluetooth a shot here. Let's try the scan. So again, we'll take a look at the code. So here's our includes. It's going to search 30 seconds. Okay, so what this is doing is creating a new class called MyAdvertiseDeviceCallbacks. This is the piece that actually prints any Bluetooth devices that it picks up off the scan, I believe. So initialize the BLE. Here's a rescan, and then set device callback. I think it's like an interrupt. So that's, okay, so it's creating an object based on the BLE scanning call. Then tells it to start scanning. So I'll put it in an active mode. And then, here's our results. Then afterwards, we'll just show the number of devices we found. That's all it does. It doesn't actually print them, though. Doesn't look like it does. Well, let's upload and find out. All right, so it should be resetting now. Done uploading. Yeah. Well, let's try this. Oh. Well, that's interesting. So found a device, but like I said, won't list it. So, and it's not advertising itself, so the phone isn't picking it up. So I think I'm misunderstanding this a bit. So Bluetooth BLE is more of a client server type protocol. I don't think it's the same as like pairing your headphones up to your phone. So that's why we're not seeing it advertised. Plus, we're not telling it to advertise, but I'm not seeing how we would do that. I'd found a demo where it does use Bluetooth, but it connects to an app in the Bluetooth. And that looks like it's going to be a whole new, I think that's going to be a whole thing on its own. So I'm going to leave this here, and I'm going to pick up the actual. So next time we'll set up an app on the phone that will send a signal to the ESP32 to turn the LED on and off. And I think I also saw a demonstration where we can hook a DHT up to this and send the data back to the phone. So we'll do that next time. We'll do that in our next ESP32 video. But for now, I hope you found that interesting, if not informative, and I'll see you next time. Goodbye.